Broadcasting across America and around the world. Live from our studios in Sumter, South Carolina. You're listening to PowerAndPraiseRadio.com.
Blessings, blessings, blessings to you, Destiny listeners. Welcome to another week of Destiny Talk with your host, Lady Luella Cook. I am so excited on this evening. I'm excited because we have live in the studio with us on this evening. We have none other than Reverend Dr.
Get doctor in there.
Ida Brown Cherry. Calling it into, speaking it into existence. Right. I'm telling you, she's a doctor of the word of God. How about that? You receive that. Well, she's live in the studio with us on today. Happy Tuesday, everybody. Happy Tuesday to you. And so we are today. Our topic will be triumph in worship. We are going to continue with warfare and worship part two. So last week we talked about spiritual warfare. We noted that it is real and that we're not exempt from it. We're not exempt from going through. We discuss the breakdown of the heavenlies and where Satan resides, and we, you know, inform that he resides in that second realm, in the second heavenly. And we talked about what our goal is as worshipers. You know, our goal is to reach God through our faith and our prayers, obedience and worship. And eventually our goal is to reside with God in heaven.
Amen.
To reside with God in heaven. Lady Pam is in the house on tonight. Lady Pam, say hello to the Destiny listeners.
Hey, Destiny Walkers. How are y'all doing tonight? Well, we are live and full up in here in the studio with PraiseAndPowerRadio.com. Mr. Nate Stoney, CEO, Director, Debonair is up here leading and directing the way. But we're glad you tuned in today. This is part two. And if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to call in.
Feel free to call in to us. We're going to give you that call-in number when we come back from after our first song break. But right now, we just want to talk to you about your worship. We want to focus on you today. We want to talk about, do you want to deepen your worship? Do you want to deepen your relationship? So we'll talk about the purity of worship. We'll talk about the place of worship and the access of worship. We'll talk about that. We want you to know that your worship is important to God. It is important to God. Yes. And you owe it to him. Am I right about that, Reverend Cherry?
Amen. We were created for that purpose, to worship him.
We were created to worship Almighty God. We know that worship is expressing affection to God.
Yes.
It's how we express our gratitude. It's how we express our love to him. So we worship by expressing our love and devotion to God,
mm-hmm.
by focusing our attention on God, and by using our abilities for God. Isn't that good?
That's good. So,
yes.
So everything that God gave you,
mm-hmm.
you can use to mm-hmm. worship God.
Exactly.
Everything he gave you. You don't have to say, you know, what's my gift? Everything that God gave you, your eyes, your lip, your mouth, mm-hmm. your words, your mm-hmm. hands, you can use to worship God. At any time.
At any time.
I
remember a saying when they would say, you know, fit for use for the kingdom.
Yes.
He created us that we're fit for use for the kingdom.
And as you use yourself, your mm-hmm. whole self, to glorify God, the more you do it, the more you increase.
Mm.
Just, it's the natural thing for a believer.
Wow.
It is unnatural for a believer not to worship God.
Unnatural for a believer not to worship God.
Amen.
Because we were created to worship God.
To worship him. You hear people use the terms praise mm-hmm. and worship as though they are two separate things.
Mm-hmm.
But they follow one another. They connect with one another because praise is the sound mm-hmm. of worship. When we worship God, worship means to have an encounter with God.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And when you have an encounter with him, you can't do anything but make some type of noise.
Mm.
If you don't make some type
Say
of
that.
Noise,
yeah.
if it's crying, laughing, shouting, so you have to make a response to a true encounter with God.
Jesus.
Because he's so holy that when you have an encounter with him, or what did the prophet say? I'm undone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When he had an encounter with, he said, I'm undone.
Mm-hmm.
I'm of unclean lips. It's saying, I don't even deserve to say anything to him because my lips are not clean. So God had the angels of heaven take the coals from the altar, put them on his tongue so that he could really give God, as Lady Cook says, pure praise.
Pure praise.
Pure praise. Mm. Free from contamination.
Yeah.
Pure praise.
And praise that's from the heart.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
Praise that's from the heart. And we're going to get into that on this evening as we progress through the show. But the worship, when it comes, when it flows from the heart, that's the purity in it. You know, like you said, it's when you come into a real worship experience, it's the encounter that you continually crave after you've experienced it once.
Yes, you
and will. And I know last week we talked about, you know, the voids. A lot of people, they look to fill voids in their life. But nothing can fill you. Nothing completes you like your true, genuine worship to the master. Yeah. Because it's the relationship. It's what he created us for. And I think if we just get that understanding, if we just understand our purpose, if we understand what we were created to do, and then we operate in that purpose, then what can stop us? What can be against us? What can stop us from being victorious? What can stop us from triumphing into the presence of God, into what he has called us to do, who he has called us to be? Then we can have that abundant life, the victorious life. Yes, we cannot escape warfare. And that's what we're here to talk to you about on tonight. We're not trying to say that there is some type of a magical way around it. But we know what you can do to get through it.
Yes. That's right.
We know what you can do to get through it. So as we go and discuss triumph and warfare on tonight, we want you to get ready. We want you to get ready and put on those spiritual ears and grab your pen and your notebook. Grab your word. Grab the Bible. I hope by now, because we've been on the air for a few weeks now.
Yeah.
And so I hope that you all know that that's what we encourage you to do.
Yeah.
We say go get something to write with.
Right.
We say go get your word. Get your word.
Yeah.
Mark these things in the word so that it can help you. We're giving you practical kingdom living principles, and we're also reciting to you the promises that's in the word of God.
Yes.
So we want you to grab those things, and then after our first song break, we're going to come back after the break, and we're going to talk about the purity of worship. The purity of worship. We'll be back with you after the song break.
I shall have
so glad that God gives us the ability to speak those things into existence, to speak those things that we would like to see and that we would like to have manifested in our life. He is such an awesome God. And so we thank God that he's given us, you know, not only the ability to be able to, you know, praise and express our love to him, but also give us the opportunity to make the decision on what we can speak those things into existence, what we would like to have in our lives. We call those things into existence. And so I'm so happy about that. Our scripture of focus for tonight is coming from Colossians 3, the second verse, a little short verse there. And it reads, "Set your minds on things above and not on earthly things." One of the greatest expressions of worship is when you express your love to God. And, you know, we talked about that on the trip here. You know, we always like to discuss a little of the ministry, a little of our car ministry, as we call it, on the way down to the studio. And Lady Pam, you had said something that was so significant that, you know, when we were saying, when we go back to basics, when we go back to the basics of things, that everything is rooted and grounded.
And love. We was having a conversation last night with some of our sisters, our Destiny Walkers, and a lot of times we get so far away, and one of our sisters said the ministry is so big, and ministry is becoming big, but we go back, we reel it back in, and we go back to basic. The one thing that we remember is everything is built upon love. Jesus said all the commandments,
right?
All the commandments was hinged upon love. And so if we just take a minute and we think about our ministries, just ask yourself that question. Is this out of love or this is out of me? And if it's out of you, that's when those spiritual attacks can start to attack your ministry. Because if it's not out of love, and God is love, Jesus is love,
then
you separate yourself from God. If you're not doing it from a place of love, when you separate yourself from God and you separate yourself from love, then you allow a foothold, you allow a space in your heart, in your spirit, for Satan spirits. And listen, y'all, it's not one, there are many, and he has a spirit
that
for every occasion. So just take it back to love. Prestige is good, money good, big homes good, you know, people patting you on your back good, but once you lose your focus of your ministry, once you lose that focus of your ministry, you separate yourself from God. You separate yourself from, you can never separate yourself from love.
Right.
Because God is love.
Right, right.
You just you just open it up. You just hand to the enemy, hey, come on, let's fight.
Right. And and it's so good, because like I like how you say, you know, we need to hear this and we need to know this, that there are many there are many spirits that we fight against.
Many. We can't even count them. We can't say, oh, there's a thousand, oh, there's a billion, because we do not know. But what we do know is there is a spirit to fit wickedness.
Right.
There's
right.
a spirit to fit wickedness.
Right.
If you like greed and money is all that matters to you, then there's a spirit of greed. And God and the devil will tempt you with that.
Right.
You know? And it's funny when we, these spiritual battles, because Satan is not all powerful, and he's not all omniscient, and he doesn't know everything. He's not everywhere, so he doesn't know anything. He doesn't know until you open your mouth, or you show him through your actions. As soon as you open your mouth and you say, "I want me," he says, "I got you. You go over there and get her." Soon as you look at that woman or that man in a way that you should not be looking, spirit of lust, go over there and get him. Go over there and get him. Soon as you separate yourself from love, and you just, oh my God, you are opening, you are open the door to wickedness and to
the attacks.
But guess what? God still love you.
That's right.
God still love you. So if you will come back to him and operate in a spirit of love, then he is able to arm us with spiritual weapons to fight back and overcome. Because Satan is real.
Mm-hmm.
And he is the prince of what?
The air.
Right?
The air.
So he does have power. Hey, he was a fallen angel. Mm-hmm. The number one
mm-hmm.
angel.
Mm-hmm.
But I love this. In Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Behold, I have given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. You do not have to fear Satan. God has given you the power to fight back.
The word tells us that he's already given us the victory. He has given us the victory through Christ Jesus. So what we need to learn to do as believers is to receive, believe it, and act on it. Because if we're waiting and believing that we have to be rescued every time we stumble, instead of grabbing hold of the truths of the Word of God and proclaiming them, we're open targets.
Yes.
The Word says again in Ephesians, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. And now, if Satan is not omnipresent, he can't be everywhere at the same time like God can, then we need to take our focus off of what Satan can do and put it on the greater thought, what God can do.
Jesus.
Because God and Satan are not opposites, because Satan is not equal to God. So he can't be his opposite. He's a understudy. So if we keep our focus on the greater one, I can do all things through Christ. It's a little rough right now. Didn't he say in John that there will be trials and tribulations? They're going to be attacks. But I can do all things through Christ. I can get through this. I can get over this. That word, you take that word that is the sword, the Word of God, a sharp two-edged sword, and you can cut evil back and forth. All you have to do is proclaim that word. Stand firm. You don't even have to break a sweat. Because it's not your power, it's the power of God working in you and through you to accomplish that thing that he sent that word out to do. He says, it's not going to come back void.
And we stand on a powerful word, powerful, all-knowing, almighty God. I love it when she said, look, there is no, for Satan, we call him by his name, for Satan, the devil, and God.
Right. They're not opposites.
They're not opposites. They're not opposites because they're not equal.
Amen.
Oh, I need the Destiny listeners. I need you all to catch that on tonight.
Greater is he.
Yes.
In us.
Right.
Who believe in Jesus Christ than he who is in the world. The Spirit of God is in us, believing on Jesus Christ. And if we just get that in our spirit, in our hearts, let me tell you, we will be overcomers.
That's right.
We'll be overcomers.
That's good. Overcomers. We'll be able to overcome the attacks of the enemy. And that's what, you know, we're talking about. The purity of worship. We're talking about love. Love is the purity of worship. What kind of God that we serve that will never turn its back on us and just keeps on loving us unconditionally?
Unconditional.
Worship is a love affair with God. Worship is a love affair with God. Mm-hmm. You have to fall in love. And listen, falling in love with him is easy.
Yeah.
Falling in love with him is easy. But you need to know his words. All you got to do is look around you. All you got to do is wake up and just catch that first breath and say, God, I thank you that I'm alive yet another day.
Amen.
And you can go from there. You can go from there. So, I mean, that's what it means when, you know, when we hear things like, love the Lord your God with all your mind.
Mm.
When you think of people coming up to you with complaints, all that complaining can start to press your spirit down. Wow. It's all you hear. It's like you actually feel a weight pushing your shoulder down.
Mm-hmm.
I'm tired. I don't have this. I wish I had that. The so-and-so is worrying me to death, getting on my nerves. Mm-hmm. And you know what? All you have to do is implement worship.
Mm.
Bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. Mm. His praises shall continually be in my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And the person might look at you like, that's not what I was talking about.
Right.
I know. That's what you need to be talking about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Praising God. As soon as you start praising God, God is good.
Yes,
it's
he
true.
Is.
You start praising God. You start worshiping God. And let me tell you what, your emotions, your mental status will immediately change.
Wow.
The enemy will back up off of you. Jesus did it in the wilderness.
That's right.
Satan said, I know you're hungry. You done been out here for 40 days looking at these rocks. Don't they look like bread?
Right.
You got power. Turn that rock into some bread. Mm-hmm. Both of us can eat out here. Jesus didn't argue with him.
No.
Jesus didn't say, that's not what I came out here to do. He said, it is written. He said it three times. He said, kneel down and worship me and I'll give you all this. Guess what? It already belongs to God. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Everything in it. So that was another lie he was telling.
Right.
Jesus said, it's written.
Mm-mm.
Don't tempt the Lord thy God.
Mm-mm-mm.
So when we are confronted with hardship, yes, life is going to be hard sometimes.
Right.
But when we're confronted with those hardships, just say, Lord, I love you. Help me to love you more.
Hmm.
I know you love me, and I thank you for your unconditional love.
Mm-hmm.
You start worshiping God, and he will let the spirit that's in you start filling your heart up with that love. The enemy has to back off of you. This is how we fight. This is how we fight.
Absolutely.
Ooh, I hope y'all getting that out there, because this is some good, rich some good rich teaching.
Yes,
and I tell you, I love it. I love it. I love it. Listen, God is a God who is passionate about our relationship with him.
He is.
He's passionate about that. He is concerned for us. You know, the Bible tells us to cast those cares and those anxieties. We've got to cast those things. You know, cast them to God.
Yes.
We hold on to so much. You know, we hold on to stuff that, again, as you stated, Reverend Chair, it weighs us down. And, you know, the weight can be removed simply just by us acknowledging God, waking up and saying, God, you are sovereign.
Yes.
God, how we love you. God, that's the purity of it. From a pure, you know, from a pure place. And the more you spend time in the presence of God, the more you spend time in his word, the more you develop and enrich that relationship. It's a rich relationship. And then you don't have to worry about all of those things that come to attack you, because you know that your worship, you're going to find your way worshiping through those things. That's how you triumph through those things. You triumph with your worship. You say, okay, I know that this may be facing me in the morning, but I'm going to rest and lie down in peace on tonight, because I know that whatever is going to come my way, that God, He loves me. He loves me. He's going to take care of me. He's going to help me walk this thing out. We talked about forgiveness on the way down. And a lot of times the attacks, the enemy will use that very same thing right there. Make it hard for you to forgive someone who have offended you, who have done wrong to you. But listen, we've got to learn how to release.
Yes.
That's right. Because in your unforgiveness, the only person that is getting being hurt is you.
Yeah.
That person who offended you, or you believe that offended you, because sometimes it's you, and they may not even know, you know, you can, like, you address them, address that person or address the issue, but in this time that you milling and sulking, that other person has gone about their business and gone away, and your insides is eating you up. You think about it every day. Everything and every person remind you of this incident, and you plot and plot how you gonna get even, or why did this thing happen to you?
Right.
And this is not me being high and mighty, because we all been through it, and I've been in that place where unforgiveness rested, and so I'm talking from experience when I say the people or the persons went on with their life, and I'm traveling all over the world, so I'm taking this on every continent. I'm taking this mess on every continent with me in my luggage, and it's just growing and growing like gangrene until I had to chop it off. I had to chop it off. I had to ask for forgiveness to God. Ask for forgiveness, because He forgave me and all my mess that I did. You know, He forgave me. Forgave me for all the things that I'm going to do. So I had to forgive. Did it happen right then? Poof. No, it didn't. But with time and reading the word and getting the knowledge of the word and being surrounded by spiritual friends and removing things that were unlike God in my life, I'm better now.
And like,
I'm fine.
And like Lady Cook said, a pure heart.
Pure heart.
That forgiveness has to come from a sincere heart. You have to not have some kind of a plot that you're gonna say you forgive, but you're setting them up for something else. That's not a pure heart. We have to forgive. Remember the Lord's Prayer, we say it from childhood.
That's right.
Forgive us our trespasses. As we forgive those who trespass against us. So ask yourself the question, do you want God to do you like you're doing somebody else?
That's right.
And if the answer is no, you got to get your heart right.
You have to get your heart right.
Remember, worship is an encounter with God. We who worship God have to do it in spirit and in truth.
That's so good right there. My God, my God. So we got to understand, Destiny listeners, that the winning strategy is when worship flows from your heart. When it flows from your heart. God is a first class God. Top notch. There's nobody greater or higher than Him. So don't offer God your cheap worship or stale worship. You better give God your best.
Yes.
That's right.
Give it, like I say, it could just be, God, I love you. God, I adore you. God, I worship you just because of who you are. Yes. Sometimes we just got to worship God because of who He is. Yes. And that in itself will set us up in a place. The enemy can't, he has no power. He cannot touch you when you're in the presence of God.
That's right.
He cannot touch you when you're in the presence of God. So that's what we want to say to you. That's what we're conveying to you on tonight. Genuine worship. God will meet you at any place, at any time, with genuine worship.
We were talking again on the way here, and we were talking about a lot of believers were won to Christ through New Testament scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
And they have no knowledge of the Old Testament.
Mm.
Well, that is one binder with 66 books in it.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a reason the old is in with the new, because you need to read your history.
That's right.
And the prophecies, so that you can understand your present and your future.
That's right.
You cannot throw away the Old Testament. You can't do it. You got to understand the God of the Old Testament is the same God in the New Testament.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
And as far as worship is concerned, you can't worship God when things are only going well for you.
Mm-hmm.
Or you may not ever worship him. Go into that book of Job.
Hmm.
42 books of the devil wearing him out.
Hmm.
I got tired of reading it. I know he was tired of living it.
Come on. Jeez.
You know, 42 chapters, and the devil was giving him everything he had.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But God.
Oh, God.
God knew Job's heart.
Right.
He knew that the natural part of Job would get tired, would get worn down.
Mm-hmm.
But the spirit in Job would not curse God, would not reject God, would not stop giving God praise.
Mm-hmm. My God.
He would not. He stood firm in his faith. And in the end, God restored unto Job more than what he had ever lost. Mm-hmm. Because Job pleased God with his consistent, steadfast worship.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Worship.
Ooh. Wow.
Ooh. My God. Isn't that powerful? That is very powerful. Very powerful. You want to see Jesus flow in your worship.
Mm-hmm. In your worship.
You want to see Jesus flow in your worship.
Yes.
You want to get close to God? Flow in your worship. You want to be victorious? Flow in your worship.
That's right.
Worship.
We're told that in several of the Psalms that David wrote,
mm-hmm.
he was actually in battle while he was singing the Psalms. Psalms are songs that were sung by David or the choirs of the king.
Mm-hmm.
And can you imagine him with a sword in battle? The Lord is my light and my salvation. Who shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Who shall I be afraid? When my enemies fall upon me and they try to tear at my flesh, in this will I be content, that I shall dwell in the presence of the Lord. I mean, this man was fighting giants.
Right? Yeah.
And he told the giant, I'm taking you down.
Because
you are dishonoring the God of our nation.
That's right.
My God.
I'm not taking you down so that I can win that daughter of the king.
Mm-hmm.
He was 16 years old. He wasn't even thinking about that.
Jesus.
He said, I'm taking you down because you have dishonored the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
That's right.
Mm-mm-mm. My God.
God will honor you when you step out and stand for his glory and his honor. He will honor you.
That's good. I hope somebody's listening to that. I hope somebody is hashtagging that.
Mm.
But God.
But God.
God will honor you. Mm. That is powerful. Listen, we're going to take just a quick break. because we're going to reset this thing and we want to come back and talk to you about the place of worship. Mm-hmm. We want to talk to you about the place of worship. Mm-hmm. You want to see Jesus flow in your worship. Mm-hmm. Destiny listeners, as we're getting ready to prepare to go into the last segment of our show, I hope that you all are being empowered and enlightened. Hope that you all are enjoying the broadcast on this evening. I know that I am, because there's nothing like being fed the word of God, getting full on the word of God. So right now we're going to take this segment and we want to talk about the place of worship. So we want to talk about the core and the concept of worship. The core is that worship is at the altar of your heart. That is where worship is. It's your core. It's your very being. It's who you are. And the concept, the Bible instructs us, it says, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. We were just talking about those songs. Mm-hmm. Songs from the Spirit, as David wrote in the book of Psalms, singing to God with gratitude in your heart. Ephesians 5:19 goes on to tell us, speaking to one another with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. Mm-hmm. There it goes again. It says, sing and make music from your heart to the Lord. So you see how all of that is tying in together, the purity of worship. It flows from your heart. The place of worship, it resides in your heart. Yes. We've got to learn to broaden our scope to bring greater joy into our life. That means you can't make it all about you all the time. Sometimes we do get the tendency to think that worship is all about us and our personal likes and dislikes. But the scripture is telling us we've got to teach one another. Yeah. with all wisdom through the songs and the hymns. You might not like the hymns. You might like more of the contemporary music and, mm-hmm. you know, all of this and that. But what is the Spirit of the Lord saying to you? What is He speaking to your heart regarding that thing, regarding forgiveness, mm-hmm. regarding your healing? We've got to learn to, you know, to talk about that. We've got to learn to talk about that.
And I want to just say, when you talk about the place mm-hmm. of worship, it is in the heart.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just a building that we go to. They had the temples in the time of Christ. We have the synagogues and the churches and the other places that we gather to worship. But true worship can't take place in any of those buildings unless the heart has been prepared. Sin has been confessed. Repentance has been requested. Redemption has taken place.
Mm-hmm.
You see, your heart is not right if you hide sin in your heart. And you can't get so proud and high-minded to think that you don't commit sin. I don't care how many years you've been walking with the Lord. The psalm says, if I hide sin in my heart, God will not regard me.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you put hearing aids in his ears concerning your prayers. Your prayers are not doing anything but bouncing off the wall. Because you're saying you're so this that you don't even commit sin.
Right.
Come on. All have sinned. Okay, so we thank God that He has made provision mm-hmm. for us to confess it and ask for forgiveness so that we can be restored.
That's good.
Okay?
That's good.
So it's not those places that we go to. Any area of your life that you demand control is sin. You're going to give God access. Here's that access again.
There it is.
You're going to give God access to mm-hmm. every area of your life, but this one particular area of your life, you're going to say, I got that, God.
Right.
I'm in control of that. Mm-hmm. You just take care of everything else.
My God.
Jesus didn't hold back anything on that cross. He surrendered everything.
Mm-hmm.
And when we come to worship and we sing, I surrender all,
mm-hmm.
some of us are lying.
Right.
Come on.
Sitting right there singing, I surrender all,
mm-hmm.
and don't want to say accept.
Right.
Everything, we have to give Him a key to our entire life. He has to have access.
Mm-hmm.
And He won't demand it. He won't force us.
That's right.
He wants voluntary. That's voluntary good. Surrender. So that once we get that burden off of us, we can worship Him in spirit and in truth. Let me just say this. We bring our offerings to the church. Well, mm-hmm. some of us do and some of us don't. That may be another area you need to be praying about.
Wow.
Bring your offerings. God doesn't need a dime that you have.
Mm.
But here we go back to the Old Testament.
Right.
He had a tribe of people called the Levites who gave their whole life to serving and worshiping God and serving His people. They didn't inherit any land or anything.
Mm.
And God required the people, the other 12 tribes, He required them to take care of the Levites as they served him. Now, when you go to work, do you go and tell your supervisor, I'm working for free? You punch that time card, you clock in on the computer, or whatever way you do it. But you go to work already counting the hours that you work in that day and how much you're going to make that day. Mm-hmm. And when payday come, you want it right.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Why should your pastor, your other spiritual leaders have to work for free? Why should mm-hmm. they go to work? They study. They come out and serve you for problems in your families. They pray for you. They go to school reading and pay for college. It's not free.
It's not free.
Why should you expect, just because they're preachers, that you're going to stand there and say, the preachers don't want nothing but your money? It's not true. It's not true. And I can tell you as a pastor that I worked many years, that the Lord paid my salary.
Come on.
Because the church did not. And I never missed a meal. And I never missed looking decent when I came out, because my trust was in him. I did his work. So I'm just saying to you that are listening tonight, true worship is also in giving. We worship the Lord through our offerings. And in 2018, we don't bring goats and doves.
Right.
We do direct deposit. We do checks.
Come on here.
We do cash.
Come on here. They got the cash apps now and all kind of different ways.
Hashtag to, cash.
Yeah, right. That's
and,
good.
And I'm telling you that Lady Cook, I'm saying this from my heart.
I know you.
Lady Cook is all over the United States and outside, and she is doing these conferences. She's trained in many areas and continuing to train. And I know she didn't expect me to say this, but God does. If you are withholding supporting her ministry, shame on you.
My God.
All right. I've spanked you, Nan. I'm done with it.
That's when you drop the mic on Reverend Cherry. Bless the Lord.
Yes.
Bless the Lord. Isn't that something? I tell you, it's just rich. And that's why, I guess that's why I felt so full. You know, even when we put the car in park and we was outside in front of the station, and Lady Pam was trying to help me. She was trying to tell me, like, you know, open the door. It's time to get out. And I'm like, can we just keep riding?
Right.
I said, I'm feeling fat and full. Fat and full on the word of God. She just, it just exudes, you know, it just flows. And that's also, you know, a good thing of having, you know, good connections, positive people around you, involved in your life. You know, that also allows you to be free. You ain't, you know, in no whole lot of competition with everything. It goes back to, you know, when you made your opening remarks, Lady Pam, and you said ministry is vast. It's big. You know, it's big. So, you know, there's a lot, you know, that God calls and requires of us to do in our abilities for him. But guess what? It's nothing compared to the sole purpose of why you was created, of what you were created to do. And that's just to give him a praise. That's just to give him your worship. So we want to encourage you to go deeper in your worship. Go deeper in your worship. I have three steps here for you that will help you to go deeper in your worship, because, you know, worship releases you from the hand of the enemy. Worship gives you access. Worship gives you power. The first step is establish a daily time with God. Establish a daily time with God. Matthew 6 and verse 6 from the Message translation says, here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so that you won't be tempted to role play with God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense His grace. That's Matthew 6. Verse 6. The second step is develop a constant conversation with God. Talk to Him. Worship with Him continually. When you fix your thoughts on God, God will fix thoughts on you. That's how we are kept in perfect peace. Mm-hmm. That's what Isaiah 26 tells us, that He will keep us in perfect peace. Just fix your thoughts on God. And then God will fix those thoughts. That's what I was trying to say. He'll fix those thoughts.
He will.
He'll fix those thoughts. And the third thing is surrender your thought life to God. This is one of my favorite scriptures here, coming from Colossians 3:23. Whatever you do, whatever your task may be, work from your soul. That is, put in your very best effort. Put it in. As something done for the Lord and not for men, knowing that with all certainty that it is from the Lord that you will receive the inheritance, which is your greatest reward. It is the Lord Christ whom you actually serve. Mm. Serve Him. Worship Him. Give Him honor and give Him praise. Give Him His due diligence. Again, there is no one greater. There is no one created greater than God, greater than the God we serve, greater than the God we worship, greater than the God that we give reverence to. Just think about the goodness of God. And then those attacks and those things that, you know, that come after you, when you just fix your mind and you just fix your heart and get in a place of worship, they have no power. They have no dominion. They have no authority over you. Worship. Flow with worship from the heart. Remember, it's not what you do that matters. It's who you do it for.
Amen.
Worship from the heart.
Worship from the heart.
And as we close, I want to encourage you all to go to our website, ladycookministries.org, to find out about all of our fall upcoming events. We have some events coming up. We'll be in Florida in November for a Women's Empowerment Conference. And listen, if you would like to sow into this ministry, you can also sow your love donation into this ministry by going to the website and clicking on Sow a Seed. This is good ground. We are all about our Father's business. We are traveling to tear down the borders, and we're reaching our sisters and brothers in Christ by spreading the love and the knowledge of who He is. That's what this glow is all about, because we know that God truly and genuinely lights our way.
Yes, He does.
So, Destiny, look, listeners, your destiny, it awaits you. Walk in it and live through it. May God bless you the rest of your week. And until next Tuesday, much love, much grace, and much power. We love you.
We love you. God bless.
Love you.